Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. We have come together today to remember the life of John. John was, of course, somebody who was so very special to each and every one of you. And so today we come to honour and to pay tribute to his life and to express our love and admiration for him. We also come to give thanks for his life. It is, of course, only natural that each one of you should feel sad today, because in a practical sense, John is no longer part of your lives. We must die, each one of us know that, but whenever death comes, it brings with it a multitude of mixed feelings. For we have that powerful sense of loss, combined with a real sense of pride. Pride that we had the opportunity to be part of his life in some way. Of course, today is not the service that John would normally have been given or indeed deserves. There are, I know, many people who would have wished to have paid their respects and to celebrate and to remember and to pay tribute to the man that John was. But sadly, due to the dreadful circumstances that the whole world finds itself in, that, of course, is now not possible. And so today's service will be a short, simple, but respectful one. And we will also remember those people who can't be here with us today. And just because we are small in number, the love from all of those who knew and loved John will, of course, still be here in plentiful supply. We will now listen to our next piece of music chosen for today's service. And it is Elkie Brooks' Lilac Wine.
I lost myself on a cool, damp night, gave myself in that misty light, was hypnotized by strange delight under a lilac tree. I made wine from the lilac tree, lost my heart in its recipe, made me see what I want to see, be what I want to be.
us throughout our life builds a book of our time on this earth. It is, of course, a unique book because it's the story of an individual's life. John's book is unique because of the man he was. Many different people will appear in that book, and the chapters range over a good number of years to make it the story it is. The early chapters are of a child being born, becoming a toddler, attending school and playing with childhood friends and acquaintances. And as the chapters move on, a teenager is formed, where life begins many other facets, and during these years, the child becomes an adult. Many new and exciting friendships are forged as life's path slowly winds its way throughout middle ages and into our more twilight years, when life's pace begins to slow, and gradually but surely, life draws to a close and our time on this earth comes to an end. Today we come to close the book of life for John. It is a book of life that has been lived, with goals and achievements completed, with loves and friendships that have been sealed, and of course, a place in history now secure. As we look into John's book of life, there are of course far, far too many chapters for us to see them all here today. But I have been told about just a few of those chapters of John's book of life. And Wendy and Ian have said to me that Mum and Dad moved to Hutton in the early 1960s when Elmhurst Road was freshly built. John soon became a popular and an active member of the community, and he would remain so for some 60 or so years. John was outgoing, he was enthusiastic, and he was always keen to help within his community. Over the years, he became an active member in many different walks of life. He was a member of the parish council for over 40 years, and also proudly served them as chairman. He felt committed to projects and issues that Hutton faced during that period. Another one of his chapters and his kindnesses in life was, I'm told, that he would religiously, on a Saturday morning, wind up the church clock. He and Frank Wyatt, who was a local watchmaker, would meet at St Mary's, and they would climb the stone stairs up to the clock tower to the winch mechanism. I'm told that there was 3 winch keys needed to wind the clock, and each required increasing strength. The first, either John or Frank would wind with ease. The second, they would take it in turns to wind. And the third required a joint effort, one either side of the handle, bringing the mechanism taut and ready for yet again another 4 weeks of chimes. This was a kind and small task that John enjoyed. It was a civic pleasure rather than a duty. I'm told that John had a contagious enthusiasm for beekeeping and also local history. He was always happy to offer talks and do slideshows and demonstrations to any society or group who shared these interests. He was passionate about these topics, and he also held a lifelong admiration for traditional skills and craftsmanship. John also spent many years editing the Hutton News, and he was active on the Village Hall Committee. John felt committed to contributing to the community, not only for common purpose, and also for getting a job done, but mainly because he just loved people. Paul has also given me just a few lines, and Paul says that John was a man with a heart of gold, a heart so full of love that it was infectious beyond what could possibly be touched upon here today. Paul has told me that his granddad accomplished many a great feat throughout his incredible life, but he was never too proud, or never did he brag about these accomplishments, some of which are certainly worthy of their very own special recognition. The very top of his long list of achievements were his roles as a father, a grandfather, and a great-grandfather. All three were roles that he loved unconditionally, and they were without any doubt his proudest effort, and he made it look effortless. Paul says, "My granddad was not a man who found importance in value of material possessions. Instead, he felt his very wealthiest and luckiest sat among a party of his nearest and dearest, his closest family and his close friends. He was always so happy to be with his family. It was a family that he loved so deeply, and of course they loved him in return in equal measure. John was a father, a granddad, a great-granddad, and best of friends to everyone who had the privilege to know him." Please feel free to join with me in saying the words of the Lord's Prayer if you so wish. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And we will now listen to another piece of music, and it is, I know, a beautiful piece of music, where we can sit and we can remember John, we can remember the man he was and what he meant to each and every one of you. And so, sadly, it is we come to the final part of today's service. The part which, of course, I know is always the most difficult and the most painful, as we must say our final farewells to John. But as we do so, we remember him as he was in life. We pay tribute to him as we come to bid him a very sad, yet a very fond farewell. For in the presence of death, we stand somewhat awkward and ill at ease. For death is that well-known stranger whom we recognise but do not wish to know. But death is not a thing in itself, but merely a stage in the journey of life through which all must pass. It may come swiftly and catch us unawares, or it may come slowly with laden feet, but sadly, death comes to all those who live. Treasure the memory of your words, your achievements, and your character, and your many, many qualities. May the light of love shine forth upon you and on all those who care for you. May you be forever blessed with peace and understanding as you travel on. May you come to the end of your journey in gentleness. Heavenly Father, by your mighty power you gave us life, and in your love you have given us new life in Jesus Christ. We now entrust our brother to your merciful keeping, in the faith of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Your death, but with so much gratitude for your life, we come to commit your body to be cremated. We honour the way you lived your life, and we honour the love you shared with your family and friends. And as we come to say farewell to you now, remember that you will be loved and cherished forever by all those whose hearts you touch. Thank you.
10 years ago. That's you, with recording, she's not sure if that's going to go through because apparently there's been some change, which nobody's told me. But she said she's going to send them the email, like she normally does.
Right.
And hopefully it'll work. But she said they've been told that they're not doing it because there's people not working from there, they're working from home or something or other.
Oh, I see.
So it probably would have been recorded. It's whether they can get someone to put it onto a link to share it out.
Right.
Or something.
Okay.
So I don't know, you might want to just say there's a. Yeah.